Check, check, check. Check, check, check.
I don't know. No one, within our group, no one did anything official. Matt talked to him, they invited him up to come out. He's doing really good. So it's all HTC side, like heavy gun and hardware. So he talked to Chet,
I'm I'm not having a lot of fun. I'm not having a lot of fun.
Whatever way is designed problem I've had before is really studying the
Thank you.
starting just 1 minute. Maybe 1 minute to make your way to a seat if there is one available. If not, find a spot. Finish up your demos. I would ask you if you have demos, please hold your demos until after the talks are over, because when you're in virtual reality, you're not here and you don't realize that we can all hear you. All right, that was fast. Amazing. All right, everyone. Welcome to SVVR number 26 at Roblox. Thank you, Roblox. All right, we're just coming up on the third year anniversary. Very soon, not quite there, but very soon, third year anniversary. We just got back from CES, which was amazing for VR. A lot of people in this room were at CES, so get all your CES questions answered. We have some amazing guests tonight. We have Tony Parisi, the legend. Yes. With his new book, we'll tell you all about that, but definitely check out Tony's new book. We have David from Roblox, the CEO of Roblox, who is speaking about Roblox and VR. And we also have a really interesting looking startup called Metta. Not the Metta you're thinking of with one T, this is Metta with two T's. And I don't know where they are, but they're here somewhere and they're awesome. There they are. All right. And we also have a special surprise guest that we have the Nokia team over here. They're not presenting tonight, but they brought the crazy OXO camera right here. This beautiful piece of machinery. I got to play with at CES. Ozo, I'm sorry. I keep doing that. You can zap me and shock me every time I do that. And we'll be doing some Vive demos here. There's a lot of demos all around. Another Vive over there. So with that, we're just going to dive right into it. Tony Parisi is going to lead the way here. Whoops, wrong order there. And I'll get your presentation ready if you want to take the mic. Let's hear it for Tony Parisi.
Hey everybody, how's it going? So I've been doing VR for a long time, by some measure, a little bit over 20 years. And related technologies, 3D visualization, 3D for the web, technologies like VRML, or recently WebGL, which is 3D running in your browser, running everywhere. Wrote a few books on that, and then I had the crazy idea that I was going to write a book on VR as well, which is actually over here. So I'll sign books if you brought your book, if you've already bought it. They're for sale here too as well, unabashed plug. And thanks very much, Carl, and thanks David and Roblox for hosting. This is awesome. I actually worked for Roblox for about 6 months as a consultant and built the Macintosh version of the Roblox client, ported that from the PC. That was a lot of fun. So you know, we have a long history together, so I'm happy to be here and be back. The other thing I do is I'm the VP of Web and Open Technologies at Wevr, which is a fairly well-known VR startup based in Venice Beach, California. So I'm up here in the Bay Area, I'm in San Francisco. I'm the Wevr North office. You got your Eco Theta right there, all right, man. And I'm looking at web and open technology solutions for Wevr. Today I wanna talk about how virtually anyone can make VR. So the dream at CES, the dream of Oculus and Vive and high-end VR is so awesome. The places that VR can take us to are truly astounding. This is a screenshot from me at Valkyrie. If anyone's tried the Oculus demos, you've probably already tried this, and it's amazing. You're in the cockpit of a space fighter, and it is an incredible experience. And, you know, VR is going to power all kinds of experiences like this, and that dream is what brought the Silicon Valley VR Meetup group together. How many years ago now, Carl?
Yeah, just about three.
Just about 3 years ago. That's the dream that fueled the Kickstarter campaign that got Oculus started, and here we are, and that's a great dream. Of course, the reality, as we now know, is that these systems are a little bit expensive, and Oculus announced its price for the pre-order is $599, not including shipping, not including the touch controllers, not including God knows what, including Valkyrie, and Lucky's Tale, so there's some bundle software in there, but otherwise, feel maybe a little bit out of reach. I mean, you not only think about the price of that, but the price of a computer to run this stuff, as the min specs have escalated over the last little while. We're talking about maybe another $1,000 to $1,500 for the box. Now we're in the realm of a couple of grand to run high-end VR. And that's wonderful, but not everyone's going to be able to afford that anytime soon. We assume those prices will drop, right? We know over the next few years, if this is a big wild success the way we all picture, these systems will get cheaper, computers will get faster, the min specs will change, but you know, we'll be able to buy this stuff in an affordable way. If we want to make content for this though, let's think about what that means. How do you sell a system like this? You sell a system like this because there are AAA game titles. There are big studio cinematic experiences. These are things that you'll either buy or get for free that you're going to enjoy the system with. If those don't exist, these things won't sell. Those things are very hard, they're very expensive to create. So if folks in the room are thinking about creating VR, and you want to create it for these systems, you may be looking at big budgets and looking at a daunting task. You know, real pro tools, big teams, $10, $20 million kind of exercise for the high-end stuff. And you know, maybe that's not for most of us, the rest of us, the people who funded the Oculus Kickstarter, but it's where it is today. For the rest of us, we're going to be doing a lot of 360 video, 360 photos, using Gear VR, maybe cardboard systems. Maybe we're building you know, small Android games using a tool like Unity, and lower budget stuff, but you know, we're in this realm of low budget. You know, on the high end of that, it's affordable Gear VR. On the low end, it's your cardboard, which isn't as good of an experience as we know, but boy, everybody can get into the game with that. So what I'm gonna here to talk about today is this part, how we build for this. So I decided to put together a little prototype today to talk to you, you know, basically in the spirit of the book that I just put out with Amazon, how anybody can make VR. I'm going to show you an app I built in about 90 minutes today using web technology. So I'd like to introduce DERP, which is the DOM-based equirectangular photo viewer. This is all built using web tech, so DOM being the document object model, and 3D markup tags. And with that, Carl, I'm going to attempt here to pull up your browser and launch this demo. Let's see how this goes. We had a little bit of machine putzing we had to do a few minutes ago, so apologies.
So this is
the full screen version of an equal rectangular spherical 360 photo. This is the new workspace of Upload VR. Folks know about Upload VR based in San Francisco. This is their new office. They're just moving in. I did a walkthrough with them this morning. I'm an advisor to the company, a friend, and they kindly let me come in. What I did is I used my Ricoh Theta, my $350 360 camera. There's more than one of these in the audience today, wow. And I just went like this. Come on, it's here, let's go. And then, you know, what I did was I used the little Theta app, which is, you know, you get on your phone, you Wi-Fi to the camera, and grab the photo, and you can quickly share via Twitter. You can share via Twitter, that's what I did, it was the easiest thing. But I had to use this app, and the thing that was really killing me is the website it takes you to runs a Flash Player 360 thing. I'm like, really? Flash. Being a WebGL guy, I thought, what could I do to actually do this on the web? And what if I could have just shared this on the web and people could have hit this in a browser? Not only hit it in a browser, but... cardboard too, right? So it's just all device orientation, right? Pop this in your cardboard viewer, and you've got your 360 VR in cardboard. That's Mobile Safari running that. So you guys can come play with it later if you want. So how did I make that? Again, I used the Ricoh 360 camera, the Theta S. I used Sublime Text. I use a little JavaScript library that I put together called GLAM, stands for GL and markup. I'm going to show you the code in a minute. And with one line of script include code, I then wrote markup tags and CSS and made that little photo viewer in 90 minutes, and that included pushing it through a web server and doing git pull and copies and stuff. And I, you know, use my Chrome to preview it, and I use a cardboard viewer. That's my tool chain, that's how I make VR. That's how a lot of us are going to be making VR in the next few years. So apologies over there, you're probably not seeing this, so I'll put these slides up. They're already actually up on Slideshow. Make sure Carl has the link. But for those who can actually see this, this is the entire application. There's some CSS code that actually puts the image onto a sphere, and this is literally just the DOM element for the actual viewer object. And then there's about 8 lines of markup that creates a background
object, which is the background sky sphere, and says render it for cardboard. So that's about it. So it's really small stuff. And I'm really excited about that because I think this is the way of the future. WebGL is actually a great technology. It runs in all these browsers, and you can render blindingly fast. There's a myth that, you know, JavaScript won't run fast enough, or WebGL is somehow underpowered. Not true. You need to do some good engineering to write your WebGL code. The thing I showed you is built on this GLAM library I wrote, but I did some good engineering on top of 3JS, which is a well-engineered library for doing WebGL. So with those things in place, JavaScript can run really fast. With tools like GLAM or another one from Mozilla called A-Frame, which is a lot like GLAM, or yet another one called SceneVR, there are ways to do markup. So if you're a designer, you can just actually put together simple applications, even import models from Maya or other pro packages. So it's pretty straightforward to do some simple application stuff. And then if you're a hardcore web programmer, you can actually do a lot more. Like, this thing doesn't let me, say, upload to a server and create a gallery for me. That was just a one-hacked image on a sphere. But if I'd had another 90 minutes, I would have gone into Node.js and written a server that did that. And I would have had a full app at that point, right? And so the state of the world is browsers actually do VR pretty well, too. Almost. So I don't know if any of you folks have been playing with this, but Mozilla, you know, Firefox, and Chrome both have nightly versions that talk to Oculus Rift, and now Chrome talks to the Vive as well. And they're doing really well. I mean, they look beautiful. The problem is they're not actually refreshing at 90 hertz right now. So you'll see this beautiful graphic, no judder on the graphics at all, but that motion lag will catch up with you kind of the same way a cardboard does. So you use the thing for 2 minutes and now you're gonna start feeling it, right? If they fix that, we're gonna be in a position where you can have a system where I'm a Maya animator, I push a button, I export, it goes up to some website like Sketchfab, if you folks know about that, and boom, you pop it into your Rift and you're just running. You see that there and you're in this full, beautiful 90 FPS rendered model, right? We're not there yet, but it's getting there soon. And so for me, I love this because I don't like app stores. I don't like someone telling me what kind of content I can publish. I don't like using proprietary tools where I'm all locked into those. I like just, you know, hacking, using text editors, JavaScript, and all that. So, you know, very, very hopeful for the world that we're gonna have a free and open way to do VR soon, and cheap as well, right? Inexpensive. This is back to the, you know, what it takes to actually produce this stuff. So that's what that's all about. Anyway, I've got this up on GitHub as a URL. Again, Carl will make sure people can see these slides. Go play with that, go grab Derp. The book actually talks about GLAM a little bit, but mostly how to do this stuff with JavaScript and 3.js. There's a whole chapter on web. And with that, I say thanks. If there's questions, come find me later, because we've got a big old program here, I think. Right, Carl?
So we'll just keep going. You can do one or two. It's up to you.
All right, let's do one or two. Mr. Miranda.
Hey, Tony. I have a quick question. So I have a friend. And I promise it's just a friend. Let's start with this adult film website for VR. Would you say that WebVR would be a good platform to implement this, because you can see your porn in your smartphone and your Oculus Rift and your Vive? Is that possible right now?
We have it here.
Yes. Oh, apparently someone has it here.
Thank you.
Porn and web porn, three great tastes to go to great together. It's like a Reese's cup with raspberries on top.
You can't watch the content, but everything on it.
You have the technology?
Exactly.
Yeah, we have the tech. Yeah, I mean, yes. Now, as soon as this head tracking issue, you know, this is the thing. Once they refresh at 90 hertz and head tracking is smooth, that's going to be a great way to do it. And that is a perfect example. That is a content type that is always going to find problems going through an app store and an approval process, right? So this is a way we don't need to worry about. But that's just one content type. I wrote a blog posting about this, a ranted about 3 months ago about, it's probably longer now, about somebody who had done a Unity-based reenactment of the Ferguson shooting, and it was rejected from the Apple App Store. It was a cardboard app. And it was rejected because it was too narrow and topical. And that's what happens with app stores, right? I mean, someone was just a journalist, they wanted to make this piece, they did it in Unity, because that was the only way to do it for cardboard and Android and all that, or iOS and all that. They had no other choice. They had to put that through an app store to actually deliver that to anybody. Even though it's a journalism piece, which theoretically, I mean, that's something they should be able to push every day, not go through an app store, you go back the next day, the content's fresh. So that's another, you know, example of that that's less controversial, maybe, Chris, but, you know, the idea there being nobody should be gatekeepering that kind of content, right? Time for one more, and we can do more of this later. Or not. We silence the crowd with porn. Tip.
Hey, so I've actually been experimenting with A-Frame, and one of the things I find limiting in, and I'm not sure, I'm sorry, I haven't tried GLAM as much, but, like, even doing simple things like rendering text is not possible. Doing links between like jumping to different places and exploring is not possible.
Now text like extruded text, like bitmap text or HTML, what level
HTML
of text?
Text? Like rendered in-engine text, as opposed to like, you know, having to save an image for every single text. I mean, it just seems so clumsy. It's like I'm drawing with like broken crayons when I try to use
right. Glam has built-in text objects, actually renders it. And I actually have a thing off to the side where I found a JavaScript library that will fully parse HTML and render that onto a canvas, and so we can play with that.
Hyperlinking? Like,
well, hyperlinking is easy, yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you should take a look at Clam. Okay, good, thanks. And I'll be over there, sign the books, whatever. Enjoy the rest of the evening. Thanks, everyone. And let's go make some VR.
Bruce, our other MC, is actually at the Seattle, one of the Seattle VR meetups. We should have linked them together. We're in the same time zone. That almost never happens. Next time we have to plan that better. All right, good to go. All right. David, I'm not going to attempt your last name. You can tell us that.
Okay, thank you all for being here, and we're really pleased to be hosting you. 2 days ago, there were about probably 14 people working in this room. Luckily, we coordinated our move just for this, so it works out well. So we're going to talk a little about Roblox and our vision, and I think to kick it off, I'm going to do a real quick demo of Roblox, just to get it started, then talk a little about like where we got founded and our vision, and then show you how people build in Roblox, and then maybe show you a little mobile and VR demo. So background, Roblox is a immersive social entertainment destination. Every month, 15 million people come to Roblox, if you can believe that, so that's a lot of people. At peak times, we have a 250,000 people playing on Roblox. Our vision is to really power the imagination of all of the people who play on Roblox. So we like to think we're bigger than a game. It's an experience. We have experiences that range from working at a pizza restaurant to being a top fashion model to surviving a tornado to pretending you're a bird to being in prison. So it's all about, you know, whatever you can imagine. So let's take a quick demo, and then I'll get a little more technical as we go. So this is Roblox. I'm running on the PC version right here. And we started on the PC, but right now we have people playing PC, Mac, iOS, Android, soon to be Xbox on January 27th, and then a VR demo over here. So we will invite you to come over after and play our VR demo. One of the cool things about Roblox is it runs everywhere using the same client. Look, let's turn this down. Oh, interesting. I did not go to extend this time, so we'll just do it this way. Okay, this will be enough. Let's see if we can do that. Perfect. Okay. And I'm going to have to play looking over my shoulder. So this is going to be a little tricky, but I'll do it. So this is a game, and I'll talk a little about this game. We call this an experience, and I'm going to play kind of backwards, so let's see how good I am. At any one time, there's probably 2,000 to 3,000 people playing in this game. It's called Survive the Disasters. And when you think about this, this is kind of a funny thing for a game. It's about 2,000 people sitting around. Every 3 minutes, there's a disaster on a small island. So there's a hurricane, there's a typhoon, there's a tidal wave. Where's Luke? Luke actually created this game while he was in high school, and it's become one of the top games on Roblox. So in just a second, we're going to get a new disaster, and we're going to get to jump in. The last disaster just occurred. We're all going to fly into it. Cool architectural thing about Roblox is we auto-shard all of these experiences. So when someone makes a cool experience on Roblox, what happens is we make as many copies as are necessary for everyone to get to play it. So if we have 2,000 or 3,000 people playing, this is going to be something's going to happen to this raceway. We're all going to go to this raceway and we're going to see what happens. So let's jump in. There's going to be two disasters hitting the raceway at the same time. These players, and I'm going to jump in and play over my shoulder to the best of my ability now. Everyone playing here is playing all around the world. We have people playing on phones, they're playing on PCs, they're playing on Android devices. So I'm just going to kind of hang out here, and you're going to get to see the disaster come. There's probably a couple things to note that are pretty technically cool about Roblox. All of the vehicles on this raceway, and I don't know where the vehicles went, we're going to see them in a second, are running through a physics simulator. So we're running a distributed network physics simulator that's kind of making all of this kind of stuff happen. And Luke's disaster is actually running through the physics simulator as well. So hopefully we're going to get to see some cool stuff break down. One of the kind of founding principles. So I lost. So I died. I did not survive that disaster very well. So let's pop out of here. So when you go to your go to Roblox and look, see, I'm going to try to see if I can make this work. So let's just see if this works. Yay. That's way better, now I can see. So when you get to go to Roblox, you get to see all of the creations that everyone has made, and you can see the depth of creation. There's about 300,000 developers that are working on this platform right now. They're making about 6 million creations a year. And you can see the depth of the stack of when I kind of auto-scroll. There are people playing all of these things. We're way down, there's still hundreds of people playing, and go all the way down and keep filling that in. So at any one time, there's thousands and thousands of things being played. And if I go back to my home page, you get the idea that when I look at some of my favorites, you can see the things that I've played recently. We do this thing, I'm gonna take a look at Bird Simulator. So Luke, you're double featured today. Good job. You see a little bit about our architecture here, where as we look at the servers of who's playing Bird Simulator, you can see all the players in all the instances, and there's thousands of them. Once again, they're playing on all devices. I'm just going to show Bird Simulator because I think it's a great little show of kind of the versatility of the platform. This is a multiplayer experience. I get to be a bird here, which is actually pretty cool. And it's actually pretty cool because the bird I am survives and dies by eating insects and stuff. And it's also really cool, and we'll talk a little about monetization. Luke has been creative enough to make this a freemium experience. Let's just see if I can find something to eat. And the way this monetizes, okay, that's not good enough. The way this game monetizes is just like anything else. It's a freemium monetization model. So the players who play this, if they want to be an eagle, I think it costs 1,000 Robux or something like that. Yep. So the idea in Roblox and the idea among all of these experiences, and I'm going to leave this, is developers, you know, power not just the games that are on Roblox, but they power the monetization as well. So our vision is 3D immersive experiences, they're multiplayer, they're sharded. The developers figure out how to make the kind of virtual transactions happen in anyone. Okay, so let's talk a little about the history of Roblox, just really quickly. Last company that Keith and I and a couple of others were in was a simulation company. We actually made educational simulation software. We were inspired because a lot of people played with the educational simulator and tried to build, you know, things that blew up and, you know, car crashes and all of that. So we started Roblox kind of with that, this idea, you know, we're going to make this immersive, physically simulated multiplayer sandbox. And VR for us right now is this really amazing kind of next step. We've done like a lot of hard work. You know, we've gotten a lot of people interested in creation. We have an immersive, physically simulated environment. We can play it in multiple devices. So the VR demo over here that we'll show you is this kind of the next step. One thing I'm going to show you really quickly is how you build stuff in Roblox. So I'm just going to do a quick demo of Roblox Studio for you. Building in Roblox is kind of meta, and the reason it's meta is we have a IDE called Roblox Studio where you can build essentially an experience or a game, but you can also, with this IDE, essentially build a game or experience that is a building game. So that's kind of crazy, but what it means is because we're running in the cloud, there's a lot of creation games. We have a big game called Lumber Tycoon where you build a lumber factory. We have a game called Sandbox where you build in the game, and that all stays in the cloud. I'm inside Roblox Studio. You can see it's pretty kind of common IDE looking environment right now. A couple keys, anything I'm working on here, you know, goes into the cloud and acts as a Roblox creation. And besides building assets here, I want to show you a couple cool things about the assets we use. So I'm going to drag a little car in here, and let's put a zombie in here as well. So let's get a zombie. So these are both assets that have been made by the community. The community's made millions and millions of assets. So pretty much anything we can think about, you know, we'll find it. So one of my favorites is to look for a pagoda, which seems weird. There's a lot of pagodas in Roblox. So you can tell there's a lot of depth to the tree of what people have been making. The other thing that I want to show you that's really cool is combining kind of physically simulated assets. This is the drooling zombie with the code for that asset. So I'm in the tree view of the zombie here. I double click on the script that controls the zombie, and you can start to see the Lua code that's embedded in this asset, so that when I get the zombie, the code that, you know, controls the zombie is coming along with it. Same exact thing in this off-roader. There's probably some code deep inside here that's controlling how it's gonna work as well. So I just put a, you know, this is kind of a really quick demo. I go to test, I hit my play button, and I start to, I come in, I can kind of test this right now. The zombie has some code that's very simply going to chase me around. This vehicle is a physically simulated vehicle. It has engine, motor, all that stuff, and I can actually drive it. So let's see if I can get out of here. So I better get out of here again. So I'm going to get out. The weapon that I have also is a physically simulated weapon. It's one of the first weapons we made. It's a rocket launcher. So I'm going to take care of this guy. Go first or third person. So when we're in VR mode, it's going to be much more like this. And you can see once again the notion of everything in here is running through a physics simulator, which is really important inside Roblox. So I can publish this game, and then what I want to just, I'll discard this for now, but I'm going to plug my phone in and show you why we're kind of optimistic about the future, especially on mobile VR, just because we've done so much work to make this run in multiple places. So let's get my phone up. So we're going to go into Roblox on my phone. Exact same games are running. So these are all servers that are running right now against clients, phones. These are gonna run against the Xbox as well. And here, if we see the recently played game, I can go into this island with the ship experience, jump into that. Let's just jump in there so you see how this plays. twist sideways right now. We want to get this working with virtual thumb pads as well. And so I can go right into this same experience. You'll see this stream in on Wi-Fi a little slower, but we're in this exact same place. And this works with a lot of Roblox games. Couple things in closing, just for the vision. So our vision, I would say, like the reason we're excited about virtual reality, we feel it's kind of a combination of kind of the 2,000 year evolution of storytelling, which has tended to be kind of static up till now, and we have our 3D movies and we have all of that kind of stuff, and then the 2,000 year evolution of communication. But for us, we're excited about creating environments where we can actually do things together. You know, be a bird with someone else, or you know, survive the disasters together. And we're looking forward to how Roblox plays on VR, and we welcome you all to come and demo it. And if you want to work on this kind of technology, we're desperately looking for people who want to work on it. So thank you very much. All right. I guess I'll take two quick questions and then I'll hang out here for questions as well. Yes?
I love that you can see the LUA code.
Yeah.
Can I actually, like, I see a game that's great, can I fork that and make my own version of it? Can I inspect it and understand?
Yeah, two ways. Some developers who are making a lot of money on their game, we have some developers who are making $20,000 a month and making a living just on their game now on Roblox, so they would not allow you to fork their game. But there are many, many, many games that are forked, and there's also many, many examples. You know, we have a set of templates that you can see how to make a simple obstacle course game. Yeah?
Can you show your models and assets that you create?
So the extent of our virtual economy is we have three different things going on. We have a certain set of assets that are body parts that right now Roblox only sells. We want them ultimately to all be user-generated for sale, so we're doing a lot of work on our character with a vision that that's user-generated. Right now, the model store is all free. We also know, ultimately, there needs to be a way to sell those models. We don't want to do it with DRM, because we know it will get hacked, so there's going to be more social ways to, you know, make it make sense to sell models. Okay, thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you, David. Roblox is hiring. Check out their jobs. They have some jobs on the SVVR job board as well.
Yes.
First try, all right.
Hi, my name is Ceci Mourkogiannis, and I'm one of the co-founders of Metta, along with those guys over there. That's Guillaume Sapran, our CTO. That's Jacob Trefathan, who's head of business development. And I do design and also community development right now. So, Metta is a mobile platform for discovering and sharing events and stories unfolding all over the world in VR. More simply put, it's a virtual reality and 360 video platform. And we want to be the dedicated space that serves only 360 in VR platform. We're really excited about what Facebook and YouTube are doing for 360 video more generally, but we want to create a place that serves creators of this new medium particularly well, as well as creating a format and an interface that is truly immersive in VR. So one of our principles we talk about a lot is to design from first principles. What does it mean to be immersed? How can you display videos in a way that doesn't just, you know, put them in rectangles in an immersive VR environment? What does that look like? So I'm going to start off by showing you the Metta platform through a demo. As any of you guys who work with the Samsung Gear VR know, it's a quite massive live demo from there. So this is a recording. And then I will show you tell you a little bit about making UGC content with these recompeted cameras, for those of you guys who haven't tried it out already. It's not like filming video in a rectangle, as anyone who's tried it will know. So I'm going to show you some of the worst videos I've made using this, and this is along with some little tips and tricks. Great. So this is a Samsung phone in the Gear VR headset. And when you put it on and enter Meta, this is what you see. So it's the world. And those glowing hotspots represent locations around the world where users have uploaded 360 videos from. And interact. We try to use the touchpad on the side of the Samsung Gear VR as little as possible. So most interactions just are just triggered by looking at a certain spot for a few seconds. So yeah, you can maybe just sort by relevant or recent. And here, I'm just looking at Calais. And here's a video we have uploaded by the Associated Press about a refugee encampment in Calais. Some of you guys may have seen. It's a testament to the fact that VR and immersive storytelling is pretty fantastic for transporting you somewhere where you wouldn't go.
Go to the shop, you have to stay alive. If you want food, you have to stay alive. If you want anything, you have to stay alive. So our problem here is that the day light is too short. We need enough time to go to train, to fly, to go to England. But we lose all our time here inside the village.
Yeah, and I really recommend checking out what the Associated Press is doing with 360 storytelling for journalism. Ultimately, we really want to be focused on user-generated content, but as we're trying to seed our content right now with compelling content that can inspire next generation of people, and we're working with a few media companies to try and show what's really possible with 360 video. Another thing we're working on is making creator profiles really immersive, so that people who are creating fantastic 360 video using devices like this can see their work in the best possible way. So here's an example. This is an immersive profile we built for Riot, which is another media company, but it's not just for big guys like that. Here is one, this is a background featuring a Wailing Wall, which accompanies a couple of videos created by a guy out in Jerusalem who has one of these cameras and is doing a lot of tours around Jerusalem, you know, sharing his experiences. And he really wanted to have a space to share it. He's very charming. People like him. He's called Tyrone, just Tyrone. You can follow him if you want on Meta. So yeah, that's one of the things we do. We're really focused on creators as individuals and as personalities. So ideally, the flow is you go to Meta, you explore the world, you find someone who, you know, some person who you really like seeing the way they look at the world. Because we see these kind of handheld cameras really deeply personal. I'll get onto this a little bit more later, but yeah, it's really about people exploring the world and exploring the world with others. No problem. Great, so I think we have a couple of... I'll go back one second. Yeah, here's a rather embarrassing one. So obviously, our team films absolutely everything we do with the Mourkogiannis. Everything. I think last time I checked, I had like 973 360 videos recorded in the last few months, most of which are very boring. But occasionally, you get some funny ones like this. This is my fridge. Yeah, my husband is very annoyed whenever I come anywhere near food and I have my camera charged. I just like put it in the middle of whatever I'm doing. Like anytime food is near me, you'll know that my Mourkogiannis is going to be close by. So as well as building it to work with the Samsung Gear VR in headset, we also think over the next year it will be really important to have also a good experience both on mobile devices by moving it like that, which is the magic window. Apparently that's what all the cool people are calling it now, magic window, or by swiping around. And actually particularly young people, so yeah, you, tend to really like that swiping gesture. I think anecdotal, so not evidence, that's all going to take off, but I was using Periscope the other day, and someone was live streaming a video, and I was just really tired and tried to like swipe to see around. I was like, oh no, you can't do that with normal videos. And I guess that was the moment I was like, okay, everything's going to be 360 in about a week. We better move like really quickly. So, yeah, once you start doing that and you're sleepy, you know, you've kind of lost your mind. But yeah. Great, so to that end, we are making sure it works well on mobile devices, so it works pretty much the same, although we're going to be going through a redesign specifically for Android and iOS, and you can just click on the cardboard mode and do that really quickly, like in that video. Great. So yeah, for anyone who doesn't know and isn't familiar with that little... this is the Ricoh Theta. So it retails for about $350. It is HD-ish. It's not perfect, but it's by far my favorite camera. They really should be paying me to promote this so much, as is everyone here. I'm trying. Anyone at Ricoh, come find me. I'm happy to be your agent. Anyway, yeah, so what I love about it is the form factor. We at Metta are really betting on mobile phones with 360 cameras coming up pretty soon. And in fact, I didn't see it at CES, but have you guys seen the Yez Sphera? It's a camera with 360, a smartphone with a 360 camera built in, has already actually been built and it's going to be released in April. So put your order on. That's going to be cool. The reason we love working with this is because it has that, you know, phone form factor that makes it really easy to use, it's really personal. So personal fact that when I went to CES in Vegas, totally on my own, I wish I'd known you guys were all going to be there, I spent most of my time talking to my camera because I was kind of shy, and I was like, hi, I'm at CES. And I was like, is she on a phone? Like, what the hell is she doing? But anyway, I was less lonely, so that was great. I said I was going to talk a little bit about making content with these kind of things, and mistakes I've made. Most of my videos are terrible, despite the fact that I do have a background in film, so please don't judge me. I read this article by Werner Herzog, the documentary filmmaker, the other day. You may have seen it. He was pretty much saying, VR, I kind of get it. But I think within that critique of VR as a cinematic mode, he actually made some really interesting points, including the following. So you can read the quote if you want, but the point he's making is normally, in culture, we have some urge to tell a new kind of story. So, I don't know, maybe opera came out of our desire to tell stories about cities or something. But VR is kind of different because we have this technology that's really coming from the tech end, and now we're trying to find content to match it. And I actually think that's true. I think that VR tech has come first and the stories will come later, which is why it's a great time to just practice, take it out in the world, see what happens, and go from first principles, which I think is a bit of advice to give to any budding VR and 360 filmmakers. So what is something that emerges naturally out of 360 filming? Number one, accidents. So normally when you're composing a shot, you know what's going to happen. When you're filming in 360, you have no idea. So for instance, I video a lot of walks I take, and I always think I'm just filming myself and my husband, and I always end up capturing something else. So there in the middle, there's a little boy with his dad, and there's a really dramatic moment where the boy took a few steps out on his own, and I didn't even realize I captured it, and that turned out to be the best bit of the video. So these kind of serendipitous moments tend to be, I think, might be something that becomes kind of incredible and explored by artists in 360. This was a video at CES. The only accident here was that I did realize I was surrounded by literally 300 men. which was just really bizarre, which I was like, wait, I didn't realize that was a thing. But hey, I guess it is. Who knew? Gender gap in tech. anyway, group interactions. Mainly, these things are fun, especially if you know the people you're filming, because you'll notice like really subtle tensions between people in group environments. This was my family Christmas. If you spend long enough looking at this in VR, you will be like very worried about the future of family dynamics. Anyway. And then like people do random stuff, so I was trying to film this with a couple of my friends, and people just kind of walked up, and anyway, weird things happen with 360 filming. So all of you guys know it, Tony explained it really, really well, that happens with X-ray angular projections, but what I'm showing you there is like a stretched out image, which actually makes kind of no sense, but it is a quick way to show you guys what it looks like. The next little thing is multiple storylines. It's another thing that kind of works well in 360. So Sasha Unseld, who's head of the Oculus Story Studio, has said a lot about this and says that VR kind of rewards rich multiple narratives happening at once, which I think is really true. It's very, and I think this is a great quote. Someone will say, did you see when that monster jumped on that building? And they will say, no, but did you see the cop and what they were doing with that girl? It's pretty much my experience of showing the same video to 10 people. Everyone will have something else they've noticed. It's really interesting. I think you can actually learn quite a lot about by people by what they've noticed. There's this famous, this viral video going around in 360 of this like sexy space girl, and there's like a ship, like a spaceship landing, and she takes off her clothes. There's a spaceship landing somewhere else, and like all the guys are like, "Hey, did you see her take off her clothes?" And like everyone who's not like a like teenage boy is like, "No, but did you see the spaceship landing over there?" And anyway, lots of fun games we played there. Yeah, and finally, I guess the presenter. So this is actually Jacob, my co-founder. I'm going to embarrass him. At the last SVVR, I know, two SVVR ago, and
that's
Maker VR over there. And yeah, I mean, the point there is that I think presenters and people who are natural with this medium, people become more natural, people find new presenting styles. So I had a journalist talking to me the other day about, when I'm doing an interview, should I talk to someone first, then give them the camera to do an interview with themselves? Or should I interview them around a space that's important to them? Yeah, and I think different ways of involving, you know, the human facial expressions and responses in 360 will emerge, and we don't have the answers, and we're just really excited to see what our users create. To that end, we are in fact launching our beta for creators next Wednesday. So we encourage anyone who has a 360 camera to sign up. We will, our sign up is metavr.com, and we'll get in touch. And if you guys don't have a camera, go there and tell us that you want a camera, because we have a couple going around who are passing off to different people who want to experiment. We're also about to start a fundraise next week, so if anyone's interested, come talk to me. And we will be hiring. So we're looking for people with expertise in video and UX and UI, so yeah, let us know if you're interested in getting into the space. We're very excited, and I think I echo a lot of the sentiments by Tony and Roblox in wanting to empower everyone else, not just, you know, high-end production companies, to create compelling VR experiences and to shape the future of this very exciting medium. So thank you for having me. Thank you. Two questions? Or, yeah. Two questions, yeah.
So in the beginning, we were talking about both 360 video and VR.
Yeah.
Most of the demonstrations you have were 360 video.
Yes, yeah.
Are you also planning to take some of the same sort of issues around storytelling and distribution and things like that with graphics-based VR?
So I think right now we're really building a pipeline with cameras, and going ahead, it'll be interesting to see what other tools emerge to help people create, you know, graphics-based stories. I think once those catch up, absolutely. We want people to help, you know, tell their stories, whatever those are. Yes?
Quick question. I didn't catch where you guys are based.
Yeah, sure. Oh, sorry. I didn't say. We're actually based in San Francisco. Confusingly, Metta, our company, is based at Matta. Very confusing. Very Metta. Which is a media-based accelerator in Soma. And it's, yeah, they're really great. And so being there actually has really shaped some of the things we've been focusing on with journalists, etc., because a lot of their backers come from a background in journalism, which is very, very helpful to us. So yeah, San Francisco, come say hi. Yeah. Oh, was there one more question?
Sure. What's the curation process kind of for videos?
Yeah, we would like anyone's advice on this front, because it's something we haven't done yet. So right now we haven't launched publicly, so we see everything that goes through. But I think there's some big questions. I mean, someone mentioned pornography earlier today. And I think what will be really important from a ground level is just that we make sure we surface good content on the front page, because you don't want people's first experience with 360 and VR to be bad, as well as giving creators exposure who want it, who are coming to our platform because focusing on them. Yeah, I think we don't want to be totally hemmed in by traditional genre breakdowns early on. I think that'd be kind of boring. So right now we have this geographical interface that lets you see recent content from all over the world, which I think appeals to the explorer and all of us, you know, wanting to see what is happening in VR. That's what draws so many people to this exciting new medium. But in a couple of weeks, that map will be, hopefully, have too much content on it, and maybe not, too much content on us for us to have it like that. So yeah, anyone with experience in curating massive amounts of 360 videos, love to talk to you. Anyway, thank you so much.
and I wanted to show.
No problem. All right. So I just have one more quick announcement before we break for demo time. SVVR 2016 conference. Things are cranking along. We've opened our call for speakers. We announced that at the last meetup. We've had over 50 submissions so far. Some really great talks. But don't let that discourage you. Please, if you want to speak at SVVR 2016, please submit at vrexpo.com, which is what the slide would say if you could see it here. the call for speakers is open. We're going to be opening exhibitor, sponsor, and early bird registration in early February, so keep an eye out for that email. It will be, again, if you haven't heard, SVVR 2016 will be 3 days, April 27th, 28th, and 29th at the San Jose Convention Center. We're going to be more than twice the size that we were last year, so we're expecting 3,000 attendees, 200 exhibitors. It will be the largest VR industry event to date. It's going to be a ton of work. We are going to be looking for volunteers. We're going to put a call out there for volunteers. And there will be opportunities, if you're on a tight budget, to attend by volunteering for a few hours. And I also want to announce, John, you want to come up and say a few things? So, most of you know, this is John Oakes. John has been a part of SVVR from the very beginning. And he is now officially part of the team. He's a co-organizer. He's part of the SVVR team. He's John at SVVR, John with no H. And John has been really part of the team from the beginning and a huge part of the community. He's organized the Maker Faire 2 years in a row, which is a tremendous undertaking. And he also runs the unofficial Facebook page, because the official Facebook page is sad. So we are now making the unofficial Facebook page the official Facebook page. So I'm just going to give you John for a few minutes. He's going to talk about a few things.
Right. Thanks. So as the group is growing, our ecosystem is growing tremendously. And one of the things that Carl and I have been talking about literally for years, since like the first meetup, is how to add value back to the community. So that's something I'm going to be trying to work on, is programs to kind of like enhance and speed up the adoption of VR across the ecosystem, making connections between people and so forth. But to that end, kind of as part of it, is Maker Faire is coming up again. And this year it's different. In the last couple of years, it was people seeing VR for the first time on our DK1s and then our DK2s. And you know, this year we have, by the time May rolls around, a wealth of opportunities to show stuff. So this year I'd like to do something a little bit different than just having us trot out our demos on our laptops and rigs and do that thing. I'd like to maybe get some people who are interested in taking the VR demos to the next level, doing something maybe a little more artistic, a little more social, makery, and approach it from a fresh angle. So if anybody wants to participate in that, please get in touch with me. We'll form a side group, talk about it. It's a lot of fun. And I also know last year there was a Burning Man camp, and we're talking about doing some stuff more in like the artistic side of things. So it could be like several opportunities to show off whatever we can put together and create. The Facebook page, we'll post on the svvr.com site, I guess, the links, but you can just go on Facebook and search for it. Keith, stand up. He's our official SVVR spokesmodel, so the banner has this guy on the top giving a demo on a shirt. So today, we're not quite ready for it, but I wanted to put this out there that one of the things that I talked about a few times with individuals over the past couple of months is doing, at these meetups, small little side groups, sometimes at GDC, I think they're called Birds of a Feather meeting or something, around focus groups about specific issues, like VR, Unity developer tips and tricks, something very focused, where it's not really a presentation to everybody, but people who already have some ideas and some experience, maybe about video or social or best practices, or even IT issues about how to get your Vive working without screwing up the USB ports. Things like that, to put together some content that would maybe be discussed in kind of hammered out and then shared back with the community at a future meetup. So it's really just volunteer. I do have some people that already want to do some. But if you have an idea, if you feel like you're an expert, you could be a good coordinator to recruit other people, get in touch with me. We'll make connections, get people together at meetups, have little side discussions, and start delivering some of the best practices out to the people. Because although a lot of us have been doing this for years, there should be a whole other wave of people who are still trying to figure this out. I mean, like the Roblox guys made tremendous progress in a week, but we have like so much to tell them that they haven't figured out yet. So, you know, if we could come up with something like here's a document about best practices when you're doing VR user experience, would be really helpful. So there's that. Anyway, thanks. Look forward to seeing everybody. Here we go.
Yes, SVVR is growing as an organization too, so if you're interested in helping out, becoming part of the team, please contact us, contact John or myself or Nana, and we'll have that conversation. And with that, we're going to do quick community announcements. Let's keep it pretty quick, and then we'll bust to demo time. So if you have a quick announcement, please make a line over here.
Hey, not really an announcement, but I just want to ask, do a quick poll. I mean, you guys are the hardcore VR enthusiasts. Oculus has announced their price at $599. How many people actually pre-ordered a DK2 or CV1? Raise your hands. All right. Wait. So how many, including the people that are in the Kickstarter? So raise your hands too, if you're in the Kickstarter, because you kind of count. Okay. Cool. All
right. Awesome. $599 is not going to stop me from VR.
This is Dave Albert from Geopoda. I got married here last time at SVVR. My director of technology is over there. Raise your hand, Scott. Okay. We met up here. Who needs co-founders, bud? Thank you.
Hi everyone, I just wanted to say hi from the Reddit R Oculus community. I'm actually one of the moderators there, so if anyone has any hassles or any problems with our moderation team, any feedback, you're welcome to talk to me. And I'm also, right over in that corner, we're showing our own virtual reality stuff.
Worm Slayer!
Doodlesack!
I'm Doodlesack, so nice to meet you all. It's my first SVVR, we're coming over from Germany, so it's actually a pleasure to be here.
Hey, I'm Mike Yarcho, and I'm going to be recovered, but everyone remember the San Francisco Hackathon. We're having our third San Francisco Hackathon the weekend before GDC and VRDC. It'll be at Microsoft Reactor Space, March 11th through 13th. There'll be cash prizes, hardware giveaways, and so I want you to sign up at our website at vrhackathon.com. Thanks a lot.
Hey, so I convinced HP to make a VR capable computer. So yes. They announced, you got a 980 Ti in it, i7, 16 gigs of RAM. I tried to work it out so we had an HDMI port in the front, but that's going to take a little bit more tooling. You know, cable management is a pain. But anyhow, for the upcoming conference, if anybody is going to be living there and needs a loaner computer or something like that, come see me and I'll try to hook you up. Yeah, I think we'll probably have a group there too, but we'll get a workout. Yeah. Anyway.
Awesome. Thank you.
Hi everyone, my name is Ceciliana Trevino and I host a demo mixer called Off Planet VR. It's in Berkeley, California. The next one is Thursday, February 25th. And it's from 6 to 9. You can go to Eventbrite for tickets, and we're gonna have Alan Yang, the UC Berkeley researcher who was one of the recipients of the HoloLens grant, and Teresa Derringer, who is the designer over at Temple Gates Games. And if you're interested in demoing or would like to give a brief chat, let me know. Again, it's Off Planet VR, Thursday, February 25th.
Hi everyone, my name is Vasant, and I have two quick announcements. First is I'm working with Ashna, some of you may know her, and another person named Hassan, on a live Twitch video stream that we're going to do this Sunday. We still have to find the time, but I'll send out an email. And it's just going to be, if you have a project that you're interested in working on and want some help on it, we'll be available You can talk to us through the Twitch chat, or if you want to talk to us through, we'll have a Google Hangout also. You can just talk to us in person, happy to help out. And so that is just going to be a resource that we're going to try to provide. Second thing I wanted to mention is I'm demoing a new input solution that I developed using an open source project I developed called Navi, which uses an external smartphone as a keyboard for the Gear VR. So I'd love some user feedback on that and see what you guys think. And also, if you're new to VR, I also have a game that if you want to try out, you're more than welcome to.
All right, and just if it's not on your radar, VRLA Winter Expo is coming up in just a couple weeks. There's also the Unity Vision Summit coming up next month, and I'm sure there's more, but we'll get to that next month. All right, and with that, let's break for demo time. We are going to be doing demos up here. Give us a few minutes to get our lighthouses calibrated and whatnot. And if you don't mind helping out, if there are folding chairs around you, if you don't mind helping out by folding up your chair, and let's get those stacked so we have a little more room to move around. All right, break for demo time. Thank you all.
Thank you. anybody have a second? I'm sorry. sure.